Kickaxe from Saskatchewan, Canada, was formed out of a band called Hobbit in 1976, which included Larry Gillstrom on guitar, Victor Langan on bass, and Gary Langan on vocals and drums. They'd add second guitarist Raymond Harvey in 1979 and relocate to Vancouver to get more exposure. But Gary was unwilling to move, and he'd be replaced by Brian Gillstrom. They'd record some material but scrap it entirely after deciding to search for a more distinguished vocalist. They'd find singer Charles McNary, and in April 1981 would make an appearance on Street Rock, a compilation album produced by Playboy of all things. You better keep on dreaming. Their track, Reality is the Nightmare, is fairly light, but still catchy, and overall, the instrumentation is great, with slick guitar work and pummeling drums. We'd also get an official Kickaxe single in 1981 with Weekend Ride. Waiting all week for my weekend ride. Charles would leave in 1982 to be replaced by George Kristen from Milwaukee, Wisconsin in 1983. And soon after, Kickaxe would sign with Pasha Records, who had just released the number one album in the country, Quiet Riot's Metal Health. In a perfect position to be the next big thing, Kickaxe released their debut album, Vices, in May of 1984.
We did that in Hollywood with Spencer Proffer. He came and saw us playing in a tavern in Edmonton, a real godforsaken hellhole tavern. But we laid it down, and the song Heavy Metal Shuffle, when we played that song live, that's it. He said, okay, in 3 weeks you have to be in Hollywood.
Overall, Vices is super solid. It does have a lot of mid-tempo tracks, but what it lacks in speed, it makes up for with catchy melodies and groovy riffs. Gonna stay on top. That's life. Gonna live it up all night, every night. Gonna stay on top. That's life. Gonna live it up all night, every night. And while Charles McNary was a capable singer, it's hard to deny that George Kristen adds a ton of personality and a set of killer pipes. Am I losing my sanity? Am I crazy? No. There's definitely a glammy attitude with a big focus on melody, but there's still a heaviness with the drums and bass. Plus, the guitar work here is excellent. There's some faster stuff on here too, though, like Cause for Alarm. Can't you hear it right now? was one music video from Vices for a great track, On the Road to Rock, and what a video it is. First, we're in what I have to assume is heaven, because we see Mozart, Beethoven, Bach, and another guy working on compositions while the Vice supervises and complains about the lack of originality in music.
Well, I'm bored with all this music I've been hearing lately. What are you guys working on? Give me a break.
For some reason, he expects these 18th century composers to have fresh ideas, but they just play their most well-known material, and Vice isn't impressed.
Stop that, you whip!
But luckily for him, the janitor is cleaning up nearby and listening to the new Kick-Ax album on his Walkman.
That's great! Playing my songs! Who's that?
Why, that's Kick-Ax!
Where are those guys? Where can I find them? I gotta see them. Where are they?
The Vice is desperate to see this awesome band, so we're whisked away to an 80s high school where a hot teacher's class is interrupted by a sudden Kick-Ax performance. George is barefoot, which is interesting, and also, in the 80s, for some reason nerds could not handle metal music. But of course, the hot teacher and the rest of the class are magically turned into total metalheads. Not content with only disrupting the education system, Kick-Ax also crashes a boardroom meeting. It's impossible to tell what kind of company this is or what they sell, but it hardly matters because from now on, they're in the Kick-Ax business. While the album didn't even break the top 100 on the Billboard charts, the response to Vices seemed positive, including this masterpiece of journalism by Terry Robert Fleming, sporting the headline, Band Releases Album. But he also says Kick-Ax covers songs by Led Zeppelin and Judith Priest, so who knows what's up with old Terry. And speaking of Judith Priest, it turns out Rob Halford was a fan as well, and hand-picked the band to open for them on tour.
We were very fortunate that Judas Priest heard Heavy Metal Shuffle on the radio, apparently in Calgary, Alberta, and tracked us down. Came to our show in Winnipeg, and it was that night that they said, okay, well, we want you to start on tour with us, and we thought it was just a dream.
In 1985, Kick-Ax would release their second album, Welcome to the Club. This one leans a bit more into the commercial side of the Kick-Ax sound and doesn't quite have the rock anthem vibe of Vices. But Welcome to the Club is still really good overall. There are a couple of tracks on here that don't really work for me, but Welcome to the Club still has some excellent songwriting and is a really easy listen. And even if this is a bit of a lighter album overall, the solos still always deliver. Unfortunately, the only promotional video that was shot for the album was for the closing track, a cover of With a Little Help from My Friends by the Beatles.
What would you do if I sang out a tune? Would you stand up and walk out on me? Then be your ears and I'll sing you a song. I will try not to sing out of key.
There's nothing wrong with the song, obviously, but it also doesn't really feel like the same band that did On the Road to Rock either. And it's cool that there are other Canadian rock stars involved, but the way it's shot makes you half expect to see a phone number at the bottom telling you where to donate. But I feel like the video just didn't do the band any favors as far as representing the sound of the album. And while George is still great on here, he also feels a bit more restrained compared to the first album, where he's practically tearing right through your speakers. Which is a shame because he's clearly got plenty of energy.
Canada! It's good to see you. There's probably a lot of heavy metal hard rockers out there, probably just getting up about now, you know, what is it, 1 o'clock or something? You know, and you're probably at the party last night, and you probably got, you know, a couple extra bucks change. I know I got a couple extra bucks change I'm gonna give. Why don't you lay it on them, huh? It's for a good cause.
The following year, Raymond Harvey would leave the band, and Kick-Ax would continue on as a four-piece to release their third album, Rock the World. Once again, this is overall a really solid album and feels like a return to a heavier sound. There are several standout tracks here for me with the incredibly catchy melodies and effective vocal harmonies you'd expect from Kick-Ax. The bass and drums continue to be super heavy, and the guitar work remains absolutely stellar. And there is a little variety on this one, like a decent Fleetwood Mac cover, and the closing track, which has a cool prog metal vibe. But most of the stuff on here just rocks, like the title track opener, which got a music video. Months later, Kick-Ax would appear on the Transformers the Movie soundtrack with two songs. However, they'd be credited as Spectre General. So a apparently these were from tracks recorded shortly after Vices for potential use on Black Sabbath's Born Again album, which Spencer Proffer was briefly set up to produce. They would ultimately not be used on Born Again, but a couple would end up on the Transformers soundtrack, released by CBS's Epic Records, who was also Kickaxe's label in their home country of Canada. One source cites vague legal complications for the name change, but another one says that Epic was actually concerned that Kickaxe sounded too much like Kick-Ass for a PG-rated film for kids. So they and Spencer Proffer came up with Spectre General as an alias for the soundtrack. But regardless of the reason, following Rock the World and the Transformers debacle, Kick-Ass and CBS would part ways. Kick-Ass would more or less disband after this, and it wouldn't be until 2002 that they'd get back together, this time with original vocalist Gary Langan, since George had prior work commitments. This lineup would release the fourth and most recent Kick-Ass album, simply titled 4. This one has an overall lighter rock sound and even goes into some proggy elements. And I'll be the first to admit that I'm no expert on mixing albums, but this one just feels really dense, if that makes sense. As opposed to the previous albums, where the instruments were all very isolated and prominent. Like those heavy-ass drums, for example, are totally lost. That said, Gary is a nice fit as a vocalist, and there are parts on here that I do like. What can you say? So I'm not super crazy about this one overall, but it is cool to get to hear Gary on vocals. He would leave the band in 2008, but Kick-Ass continues to perform with their current singer, Daniel Nargang. It's very possible you could catch a live Kick-Ass show soon, and so in preparation for the road to rock, here's your homework. Vices from 1984, Welcome to the Club from 1985, and Rock the World from 1986. All great melodic metal albums with excellent vocals and outstanding musicianship from everyone involved. I hope you guys enjoyed this look back at Kick-Ass, an often overlooked band that should have gotten a little more recognition than they did. As always, thanks for watching, and see you next time.
We're kicking ass, we're gonna take a little break, we'll be right!